want to read ahead, but I kind of want to.
I know, right?
Parenthood is telling your kids they can't eat brownies for breakfast,
then eating brownies for breakfast after they leave for school.
Or oatmeal cream pies, let's be real.
I asked my mom today who she likes more between me and my brother. She replied, I actually don't like either one of you.
There are Olympians who began intense training regimens at age 5, but sure, son, keep licking the bathtub.
Stay in school, kids. No, I mean really, don't come home. We need a break.
My 4-year-old just shut the bathroom door on me
while I was inside and told me I was in jail, so I locked the door. I love this game.
Currently helping my son search for his chocolate that I ate last night.
Yeah, I've done that.
I was in the car with my mom and told her she was my best friend. She then told me she wants me to have actual friends.
I don't care how cute your kid is, when you wake up in the middle of the night and see them standing next to your bed, they are terrifying.
My mom texts me LOL when I'm having a bad day because she still thinks it means lots of love.
Sorry I'm late. My son notices pupils were circles and he wants square ones.
What I say to my son, get dressed.
His interpretation, stand around naked watching television with one sock on. I may have written that tweet.
Air day.
If you wait long enough to make dinner, everyone will just eat cereal. That is so our house.
My toddler woke up upset because he couldn't find his glasses.
But what really set him off was when I told him he doesn't even wear glasses.
He's trying to be a hipster.
Being a parent means hiding in a closet to eat a donut so you don't have to share?
No. You don't have a donut. They're all gone. No, I've never done that.
Oh, that's awesome.
Good morning, CrossPoint. All right, y'all. Happy Mother's Day. I'm so excited to get to hang out with you guys. I love this church. I love who you are. I love what you stand for, and I love what you do. And I don't miss for a second what a big deal it is that I get to be with you today. And that I get to share, so thank you. It is certainly my honor. Now, you know, because it's Mother's Day, I've got to kick it off with pictures of my kids. Like, that's just, you got to do that. So let me show you pictures of my boys. I'm a mother of 2 little ones, Carter and Conley. Carter is 2.5, and Conley is 8 months old. And this picture was just taken on pretty much an average day. They just sit and swing like that all the time. They're happy all the time. They get themselves up, pick out matching clothes. I mean, hold hands. They never cry. I don't even think they really have tear ducts. They love each other. Like, Mom, take more pictures. I'm like, okay. That is not what this is like. This is what this is like every day, all day, every day. Can I get an amen from the moms, right? Your phone is full. Your storage is full of these pictures, right? You're doing, if you're happy and you know it, you're dancing like a clown, you're doing anything you can to get one good picture. And then we frame that picture, which is just comical to me because we have our whole house filled with pictures of that first one, like they are always happy. We are delusional. Like, we need to frame these pictures because this is reality, right? Like, this is what we live with every single day. You know, being a mom is hard. And I was thinking about this whole Mother's Day message as I was thinking about what I was going to prepare for you guys, and I realized that us moms have gotten the raw end of the deal, okay? Mother's Day is one day a year. Now, we celebrate moms, we get roses, all that kind of good stuff, but let's contrast that with birthdays, okay? So my boys, Carter's birthday is in January, Conley's birthday is in September, and on their birthdays, we will celebrate them. We will throw them parties. We will eat cake and ice cream. We'll give them presents. We'll tell them how great they are. And the same is true for your kids, you know, on their birthday. You will make a big deal all about them. Now, let's just think about this for a second. What did they do so extraordinary on their birthday? Right? Like, what did they do to get here that we need to celebrate them? You know who does all the hard work on their birthday? The father, right? No, the mother. Right? We do. So I got a new plan. I got a great plan. We're going to get Mother's Day still, but we're also going to get every single birthday, we're going to celebrate the mama, right? And it's only fair because if you got one kid, you get one extra day, 2 kids, 11 kids. You need to be celebrated 11 times. Like, this makes perfect sense. So I'm going to start working on that for you guys. But, you know, Mother's Day is a really fun time. And it's funny, as I was thinking through this, I realized, you know, my generation of mothers, so for those of you that have young kids, it's really different for us than it was for my mom. So now you got all these standards and safety and all this stuff. Kids are gluten-free and, you know, they got allergies. They're dairy-free. They're vegan. They got iPhones in elementary school. They, you know, have more straps on their car seat. NASA could launch them into outer space and they'd be perfectly fine, right? I know, because it takes me 45 minutes to get my kids buckled in to go 2 miles down the road, right? And for me, growing up, it was totally different. For me, well, let's tell the story. I walked uphill to school both ways in the snow, right? Like, for me, but seriously, I remember riding on the hump seat in the Oldsmobile. Y'all ever do that? You know what I'm talking about? You just ride on that hump seat, and here I am, ta-da. I turned out fine, right? Everything worked out. I remember also, my mom had a little cake shop, and she had a delivery van that had no seats in the back. And so we would just put a bunch of sleeping bags in the back of the van, and that's how we'd ride to Florida, just sleeping, playing board games. Like, it was a great time. I also would do some really creative things in our house that, looking back, were not so safe. I remember pulling my twin bed. That's like a seven-year-old. Pulling my twin bed, the mattress, off the box spring, and I'd shove it to the top of the stairs and then hop on and just ride it down the stairs, like knocking off picture frames the whole way. Like, we just made it work. We got real creative. But it's interesting because my mom and I, our kind of story is a little bit different as well. My mom was a single mom, and she looked up one day when she was 33, she was my age, and her life didn't really turn out like she expected it to. She was a young mom. She had a new baby, a six-month-old to raise and support, newly single, and she had $64 to her name, and she had to find a way to survive. She had to find a way to make a life for us together. And so mom was really resourceful. She kind of went into that survival mode, and she had always known how to decorate cakes, so she decided to create a bakery in a little front showcase window of a candy store in downtown Nashville. And she started with $64 to her name, and I have countless memories of this cake shop. I remember when she would take me down there at 2 and 3 and 4 in the morning to bake. And she would, she had these pallets of powdered sugar and flour. And she would, they were 50-pound bags. And she'd take these comforters from her house that she wrapped me in when she got me out of bed at 2 in the morning. And she'd lay them on these bags of powdered sugar and flour and make a little bed for me where I would go back to sleep until it was time to go to school. And then I'd go to school with the smell of flour and sugar in my fine white blonde hair, which, by the way, sleeping on sugar when you're a kid is like a dream, right? So fun. I also remember she would take me down there in the walker. By the way, why did she dress me like a boy? Can we talk about that? I already didn't have hair until I was like 3 years old. I didn't need any help in that department. But mom would take me down there, and I remember being 6 and 7 years old, and I learned very quickly which button on the cash register opened the cash drawer. I didn't know what NS meant, but when you press that button, the cash drawer opened, and I'd grab some ones and head down to the arcade, and it's no surprise that my mom's bookkeeper hated me because the cash never balanced at the end of the day, right? Thanks to me. I also remember constantly having stories and memories. I would play on her baking racks, and when she needed to cool cakes, I'd say, "I'm sorry, my babies are sleeping in their bunk beds," right? But the cake shop is the backdrop to my entire life. I have countless memories of the cake shop, of growing up, mom and I. It was her and I against the world. And whether it's back then or today, being a mom is hard. You know, we laugh at those mom tweets, but it's true. It's really, really hard. Sometimes it can feel like a struggle. That mom guilt is real. And it's probably, there's dad guilt too, but I think we experience it differently. That guilt nags at you no matter what choice you choose. If you work outside the home, you feel guilty for missing out on class parties and field trips and things. If you actually are at home, then you feel guilty for not working outside the home. You're constantly evaluating your choices. You're constantly feeling like you didn't do enough or you could have done it better. Or maybe all of these decisions that you have to make for these little lives that God has entrusted you with could be wrong. It's being so tired you can't think, and so mad you can't see straight, and so sad that you're so tired and so mad so often. Now, I know that some of you sitting here today, some of you watching, may have some wounds around this day. Maybe it's a wound from your own mother. Maybe it's a wound from a loss. Maybe it's a wound from your own desires to be a mother. I don't know your story, but I do know that God does. And so my prayer for you today, as we get to spend a little bit of time together, is that God gives you exactly what you need, exactly where you are. So wherever you are today, if your dreams of motherhood have been fulfilled in more ways than you could ever imagine, or if it feels like something you're just struggling to get through, I want you to know that today Women, we honor you. We honor biological moms and adoptive moms. We honor working moms and stay-at-home moms and godmothers and grandmothers, regardless of your titles or roles. We honor those of you that love and those of you that mother. And I want to give you just three pieces of encouragement today. Three pieces of encouragement on how you can live with less guilt and a little bit more grace. The first piece of encouragement I want to give you is that I want to encourage you and invite you to be who God created you to be. I want you to be who God created you to be. Now, I want to back up really quickly and talk about a story in Scripture that you're very familiar with, but I want you to try to hear it for the first time because there's one specific line in this story that so many of us miss, okay? So let's back up. I know it's Mother's Day. We recently celebrated Easter, but I want to back up St. Patrick's Day, Valentine's Day, New Year's Day, all the way to Christmas, okay? So we're going to be talking about Christmas, and I want to look at a specific passage in Scripture in Luke. Now, obviously, Christmas is where we celebrate the birth of Jesus, the birth of the Savior of the world. But I want to focus for a minute on Mary and look at what this must have been like through her eyes and her lens and her perspective as the mother of the Savior of the world. So let's look at what Luke says here. God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Now, Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. Like, this was scary. You're minding your own business. An angel appears to you. This is not a fun moment. It's kind of a terrifying moment here. It says, but the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High." Mary asked a really important question here. She's like, "I don't know if you know this, but by the way, how will this be," right? She's a virgin. "How will this be," Mary asked the angel, "since I'm a virgin?" And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." Now, us moms, like, we're really, really good at putting incredible pressure on ourselves. And we're really, really good at beating ourselves up when things fall short and we don't have what we need and everything's not perfect how we imagined, and we're just not as good at this mothering thing as we were hoping to be. But think about Mary for a moment. Okay, she's minding her own business, not really planning on a baby, not planning on her whole world to change. And in this moment, an angel appears to her, which again is terrifying in and of itself. But then he tells her, "By the way, you're going to give birth to the Savior of the world." Talk about some pressure. Now, here's what I love about this. What happens next in Scripture? Mary doesn't focus on the fact that she doesn't understand how this is going to happen. She doesn't focus on the fact that she's not prepared. She didn't have the nursery ready. She didn't have the wipes, warmers, and the bouncer-oo or whatever. She's not thinking about that, right? Her response is incredible here. Look what she says as a response. "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Now, here's what I want you to hear in this and notice about this response. Her response was so incredible in this moment of being scared and confused and intimidated by the job ahead of her, by the way, of being the mother of the Savior of the world. But here's why her response was so brilliant. Here's why she was so incredible. And not only was she an incredible mother, but an incredible woman in this response, because she was not focused on being a mother. She was focused on being a daughter. She was focused on being a daughter of God. She was focused on her role of who he created her to be, and knew that whatever he laid out in front of her, whatever he said to her, whatever he had planned for her was going to be good, and she could do it because her focus was not on mothering. Her focus was not on how she was going to do it, what she had or didn't have, her inadequacies or shortcomings. Her focus was on her role of being a daughter. And as a result, the whole world was changed by one woman that trusted God with the plans that he had for her. She didn't know how she was going to become a mom. She didn't know how to mother. She just focused on being his daughter. So whether you are a mom and you feel like you've lost your identity in motherhood, which is easy to do, by the way, where you feel like you've lost yourself, where you look up and you go, "Is there any of me left?" You feel like you're only a mom. Whether you're a mom in that boat right there and you feel like you've lost your identity in motherhood, or maybe you're on the other side and you've got some wounds and some heartbreak around motherhood, I want to remind you, you are a daughter of the God of the universe. You are first and foremost a daughter of the King. You are more than a mom, and that should be good news. The pressure's off. You are more than a mom. You are more than that job. You are more than just these relationships that you have or don't have. So be who God created you to be. Be his daughter. Put your focus there on being a daughter of the King. Now, being a mother is a wonderful part of some people's journey, but it's not the only thing. Because women, you are so much more. You are more than a mom. You are a daughter of the King. Now, the second piece of encouragement I want to give you is I want you to use the gifts that you've been given. Use the gifts that you've been given, the unique gifts that you have. You know, my husband and I, we moved into our house about 4 or 5 years ago. And when we moved in, we decided to plant a little garden. We have a nice backyard and there's room for it. And so this is how the garden thing goes every year, okay? We till the soil and then we go to Lowe's and we spend about $100 getting these little plants. Now, we don't start with the seeds. Like, please give me a break. They don't have a chance if I start with seeds. If I start with the plants, maybe they might make it, okay? So every year we plant them, we put these little labels in here, we got peppers and strawberries and tomatoes and all the good stuff. And every year I say this, this is the year. This is the year I keep them alive. Every year they die, okay? But occasionally it will actually produce fruit. Occasionally we'll have some tomatoes we get to eat. Recently we had a couple strawberries pop up that my son got to eat. So I think I have a little more accountability now that Carter's almost three, like, you know, going out there and checking it and keeping up with it. But here's what I was thinking about with this whole garden example, and I'm very aware that there are a bazillion gardening and farming analogies when it comes to scripture, like, you know, you reap what you sow, and the harvest is plenty, the workers are few, but it's because there are so many parallels in life. So you think about this idea of fruit and vegetables in my garden, in a garden. You got seeds, and they're all unique, and they're all different, and they, when nourished, produce fruit. But when the fruit comes out, whatever that might be, the fruit seems pretty content. Now, let's say, for example, you have a tomato. I did not grow this, by the way. I got this at the grocery store. I could never grow this. So let's say, for example, you have a tomato and a strawberry, right? The tomato does not come out and go, oh, dang it, I'm a tomato. Like, what a bummer. I'm red. I totally thought I was going to be a strawberry. Like, strawberries are more fun. They get to be in shortcakes. They get to be in fancy salads. Like, all I can do is be in a BLT. This is no fun. Like, can someone just shave off my edges and put some sugar on me and make me sweet? Maybe I can pass as a strawberry? No. They're just pretty content being a tomato. But the fruit it produces, regardless of what it is a blessing to me and my family when we eat it, when it's in our food, when it nourishes us. Like, this is a blessing when you have the fruits of the gift you've been given. Now, think about this in your life. Think about the implications of the gifts that you've been given. Each of you have them. Each of you have unique gifts and talents and strengths that God gave specifically to you, uniquely to you. You know, I work with women on starting side and small businesses. We live in this Etsy generation, this side gig generation, and so I help them turn their hobbies and passions and ideas into businesses. And when I did research with them, all of them said the same phrase to me. When I asked them how they got the idea to start that business, they all said, I had always loved sewing. I had always loved design. I had always loved organizing. I had always loved math and numbers. I had always loved fill in the blank, whatever that thing is. And what's interesting is whether you have a business or not, all of us, men and women, we all have things that we love to do. We all have things that we had always loved, maybe before life got so busy. Those things that bring us joy. Those things that are gifts we were given uniquely for us. But I love what Tom Rath says about this. He's the author of Strengths Finders, and you're probably familiar with that book. It's a best-selling book. He says in his book, although people certainly do change over time, scientists have discovered that passions and interests are relatively stable throughout adulthood. So our natural talents and passions and gifts, the things we truly love to do, last for a lifetime. But all too often, they go untapped. But see, when you use the gifts you've been given, those things that bring you joy, when you use these things that are created uniquely for you, you're a better mom. You're a better leader. You're a better wife or sister or friend. You're a better person when you're staying in your strengths and doing these things that make you light up. It doesn't make you selfish. It's smart. It doesn't make you a bad mom. It makes you a better mom. And before your husband or before your kids or before your job or your roles or responsibilities, you had a set of strengths and gifts and talents that you offered those people in your life. And if you're not careful, you stop offering who you are, and instead you just become what they need you to be. A ride to soccer, a warm meal on the table, tasks completed. And so we constantly just kind of push to the background these things that make us come alive and instead become what everyone else needs us to be. We go about the business of life, the business of marriage, the business of parenting. But I want you to ask yourself something different. Instead of asking yourself all day, every day, what everyone else needs from you, I want you to ask yourself this. What makes you come alive? What brings you joy? What gives you energy and versus sucking you dry of energy? What makes your face light up? What are those things that make your heart come alive? Because I promise you this, what your husband needs from you, what your kids need from you, what your boss needs from you, what everybody needs from you is a woman in their lives that has come alive. Your heart's desires are not bad things. They're God things. They're good things. I believe when you use the gifts that you've been given, it actually brings you closer to God. It's an act of worship as you use what he's created you to do. And as a result, people actually even see God in you when you shine in your gifts. I wonder how differently we would treat our gifts if we remembered that, if we looked at it from that lens. You know, I had an experience a few years ago. One of the things you need to know about me is I am a dog person, and I had, feels weird to even say this in past tense with you, I had a Bernese Mountain Dog, and he passed away in August. I had him for 11 and a half years, so all through my 20s, all through my adult life, it was me and him, me and Jackson. And Bernese Mountain Dogs are pretty rare. They're a little bit more common now, but I actually had to drive to Oklahoma to get him, so it wasn't very easy to find things with Bernese Mountain Dogs on them. Like, you can go get a lab, a little picture of a lab or something with a poodle, but these are a little bit more rare. So it was my birthday a few years ago, and my in-laws came up, and we were celebrating, doing presents, like the whole thing. And they handed me a couple gifts, and it was like coffee and coffee mug, and it was really cute. And then they handed me one gift that was a little bit larger at the end. And I thought, well, this is interesting. Like, I didn't really know what they had up their sleeve, but I opened it. And when I looked, I realized this took some time. They found a picture of a Bernese Mountain Dog. Now, this is really rare. They have these unique tri-colored markings, that kind of thing. And I thought, that is so cool. Like, they had to search high and low to find that because you don't see these dogs very often. And I was like, that's really cool. So, of course, I thanked my mother-in-law. I planned to put it, like, in an upstairs hall somewhere or whatever. I was like, that was really cool. So they left. I thanked them. We finished up dinner, and they left. And later in that night, after they were gone, my husband pulled me aside. And he said, Christy, I've got to tell you something. Mom didn't buy that for you. She drew it. That's not any Bernese Mountain Dog. That's Jackson. How differently I looked at this gift. How differently I looked at this gift when I realized it's not some random product rolled out on an assembly line at a manufacturing plant somewhere for the masses. When I realized this was a gift created for me by someone that loves me very, very much. How much I appreciated it. How much more I appreciated it, how much I wanted to put it in the center of my living room for everyone to see. Women, how differently would you treat your gifts if you realize they are not an accident or afterthought? They're not something to be pushed in the back of your life to collect dust for when there's time left over, and there's never time left over, by the way. How differently would you appreciate your gifts and want to display them for everyone to see when you realize they're created for you by a God that loves you very, very much? Use your gifts. He gave them for you and also for you to be a blessing to others. I love what Matthew 5, 14 through 16 says about this. It says, you are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do you light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, you put it on a stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Women, I want you to understand this. When you step into your gifts, when you use your gifts, people see God. So shine. Use the gifts you've been given and shine. After you do that, in addition to using the gifts you've been given, I also want you to have a really important last piece of encouragement. To live in the grace that Christ died for. To live in the grace that Christ died for. You know, we gotta have an honest moment here. I gotta tell you guys something recently that has just been bugging me, okay? At my house, I have a little nursery for Conley, and in this nursery, I have this little bear. Okay, let's talk about this little bear. You see what's on his chest? It's a five. It says 5 months. Now, this is where you do the little thing in the chair, right? I did it with Carter, and every month you have a little bear or a little dog or something, and they wear a little sticker that says 1 month, 2 month, 3 month, so, and you take a picture every month to see how they grow in relation to the bear, right? Have you heard this? Say yes. Yes, you know what I'm talking about. Okay, so this bear, if you'll notice, it says 5 months. My son is 8.5 months old. Last time I've taken a picture of the bear, okay? But let me just tell you what this represents to me. As it's been sitting on the bookshelf, it has been haunting me. Because every time I walk in the nursery, I see it. I saw it at 6 months, and I was like, oh, it's 6 months. I gotta take that picture. Oh, man, it's 6.5 months. I'm late. Well, I can still take it. It's still time, you know, still within the 6 month. Oh, my gosh, six months and, you know, 3 weeks, I'm getting late. 7 months, I missed it. Second child syndrome. I'm totally forgetting my second child, right? Like, I've forgotten it again. 7.5 months. 8 months. I haven't done it for 3 whole months. Now, this sounds silly, but here's what this represents. Again and again, I would walk by this bear. Again and again, it represented, you're falling short. You're failing. You're not doing a good job. You didn't take the picture. You're not keeping up. You're not doing the things you're supposed to be doing. You're not taking pictures of your kids. On and on. And it sounds so silly now, but there's this lie that gets planted and that voice that gets loud that's like, you are not doing a good job. You're failing. You're falling short. You're not doing enough. You could have done it better. Why can't you get it together like everyone else on Pinterest and Facebook and Instagram can get it together? Why can't you do the things that you're supposed to be doing? And as this voice is just kind of tearing me down, day after day, month after month, for 3.5 months, as it's going on again and again, one day I walked by and I saw the bear and I thought, well, that is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. A bear? I'm a bad mom because I didn't take a picture of a bear sitting on a chair on a certain day of the year? Are you kidding me? That is so stupid. But we do that, don't we? Now, maybe yours isn't the bear. Maybe yours is that voice that's like, you know what? Everyone else brought home-cooked meals to that potluck, and you picked up chips and salsa from Kroger again, right? Or maybe it's, why does everyone else have a clean house, and you have got peanut butter smeared all over the walls? Why is it everyone else's kids can have perfect matching clothes, and yours, if they make it out of the house in clothes at all, it's a victory, right? It's always something. That voice back there, again and again, most people walk around every day with the heavy and exhausting belief that they're not enough. They're not doing enough. They could have tried harder. They should have been better. They should have been better prepared. They should have had better stuff. Should have done it better. So I want to show you what Scripture says about this. Let's look at Galatians. Galatians says, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Another good example is in John. I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly. Abundantly. But we're too busy. We're too busy being in bondage to standards and schedules and self-imposed criticism. We wear ourselves out trying to be Pinterest perfect and people-pleasing. We're rushed and running ragged. We're busy and burnt out and beating ourselves up every step of the way. You know, I had an experience a few years ago that really stuck with me. And it was with my son, Carter. Carter's my oldest. He's the 2.5-year-old. And when he was born, it was an emergency C-section. It was a traumatic entrance into the world. And then several days after coming home from the hospital, we were back in the ER. Those first few weeks were just a nightmare in every possible way. Well, there was one particular day when Carter was a few weeks old, and it was in the middle of the night, and I was in the nursery. My husband was in the bedroom, and he heard through the monitor not one but two voices crying out. And he came into the nursery to see what was wrong, and he saw me sitting there in the glider, just weeping, weeping tears of complete defeat that I couldn't do it. I was a failure. I wasn't cut out for this. This baby should have had a better mom. And he stood there in the doorway, and he said just five words to me, and then the five words I want to say to you. They weren't super profound or fancy. You're not probably going to find them on a Hallmark card. But here were the five words, the truth that cut straight to my heart. He said, "You are doing a good job." And I cried even harder because I wanted so bad for that to be true. And women, I want you to hear me. You are doing a good job. You know, I think back to my mom. I think back to what it must have been like for her in those early days. She was a single mom. She had a 6-month-old baby to raise by herself. She was scared. I can't help but think about how scared she must have been. How much she must have felt like she was failing me and falling short. How much she must have felt like she was screwing up. And you know, sometimes it was hard. Sometimes it was really hard. Sometimes we felt alone and scared. Sometimes it was a struggle. I remember when we ran out of gas and money at the same time. I remember when we went down to the cake shop one day at 4 a.m. and it had been broken into and we were so scared. I remember when we got a flat tire in the rain. I remember when our old Oldsmobile broke down in the middle of traffic at a stoplight and we had to push it off the side of the road. You know what? It didn't look like Pinterest. It didn't look like perfection. It looked like persistence and perseverance. See, my mom didn't teach me work ethic or character or integrity. She lived it. And as a result, I live it as well. See, I grew up with a woman that was a fighter and a survivor, a woman that didn't apologize for her dreams or take the back seat in her own life. I was raised by a woman that raised a family and built a business and impacted the kingdom of God because she was brave enough to put one foot in front of the other in the direction of her dreams. So you know what? So your house isn't clean and your kids don't live in a bubble and you forgot their shin guards for soccer again and you forgot the science fair project is tomorrow and things sometimes are really, really hard. Sometimes it's a struggle. I wanna tell you something today, women. Don't be sorry for the struggle. I didn't make it despite the struggle. I made it because of the struggle. You are doing a good job. Who you are is more than enough. Who you are is more than enough in your children's lives. You are doing a good job. And I pray that you walk out these doors today and you rest in that truth about you. Let's pray. Father God, what a gift it is to celebrate the women in our lives. The gifts that you have uniquely created us to do. The way that you show yourself to the world through the heart of a woman. God, thank you for the women that have raised us and shaped us. Thank you for the ways that we can learn to love and nurture and take care of others. Thank you for the gift of your son. And God, I thank you for the truth that your words and your scripture are words of life. You do not bring shame or condemnation or guilt. We bring that on ourselves, but God, you have words of life for us. You rejoice over us with singing. You delight in our beauty, and you are for us. Your heart for us is good. Your plans for us are good. And let us rest in the grace that your son died for. In Jesus' name, amen.